Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave, and this week it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, RKO 1943, couple of very atmospheric masterpieces, The Fallen Sparrow and The Seventh Victim. Before we get into those, let's hear from Joel W. Findler from The Hollywood Story. He's got his trusty chart of contract stars at the studio. He gives them rankings, idiosyncratic in some cases, of 1, 2, or 3 stars based on his impression of how valuable they were to the studio during the course of their contract. Dana Andrews, 1 star. This is last year. He'll move on to Fox, where he will become much more valuable. Johnny Weissmuller, 1 star. Pat O'Brien, 2 stars. John Wayne, 2 stars. Robert Ryan, 1 star.
Oh,
this is an interesting one because they give him 1 star for 1943 and 44. He's away for 1 year, and when he comes back, he's got 3 stars for the latter part of the 1940s.
So. Does that track with your understanding of his career?
Yeah, he didn't star in too much during this period. You know, he's like a supporting player in Tender Comrade and Sky's the Limit, stuff like that. Barbara Hale, 1 star. Ginger Rogers, 3 stars. Anne Shirley, 1 star. We've complained about this before.
Ew.
Not right. Cary Grant, 3 stars. Lorraine Day, 2 stars. Tim Holt, 1 star. Lupe Velez, 1 star. Maureen O'Hara, 2 stars.
What's John Garfield doing there?
On loan from Warner Brothers. We'll hear from Vernon Harbin and Richard B. Jewell, the RKO story. We need to get a sense of what they had to say about The Fallen Sparrow. Based on Dorothy B. Hughes' bestseller of the same title, The Fallen Sparrow was an exhilarating cloak and dagger mellow featuring John Garfield.
Exhilarating mellow!
And Maureen O'Hara. Richard Wallace's stylish, suspenseful direction and Garfield's powerhouse performance kept audiences riveted to the saga of a Spanish Civil War veteran who returns to America after enduring 2 years of torture in a fascist prison. In New York, the hero's trials begin anew as Nazi agents use a beautiful woman, O'Hara, drugs, and psychological warfare to make him divulge the secret he held fast to during those 2 years of hell. What the enemy doesn't count on is that the torture made their target as ruthless as they are, and provided him with the determination to outwit and smash them.
Smash!
Great popular front anti-fascist talk. Also in the cast, Walter Slezak, Patricia Morrison, Martha O'Driscoll, Bruce Edwards, John Banner, John Miljan, Hugh Beaumont, and Sam Goldenberg. Warren Duff wrote the screenplay, and Robert Fellows produced.
These two movies were released within days of each other.
A lot of the same sets reused.
In August 1943, yeah, same sets. And also same composer, Roy Webb, who received an Oscar nomination for the score that year. Also the same cinematographer.
Musuraca.
Musuraca did some really great noirs, Stranger on the Third Floor, worked a lot with Val Lewton as well, and also shot Out of the Past.
So some perfect people behind and in front of the camera, generating atmosphere.
The movies felt a little bit similar in their use of this ultra-sophisticated milieu, concealing some sadists, I guess.
Yeah. These are two of the most unconventional movies of the 1940s.
Both very, very, very twisty mysteries. I've seen The Seventh Victim often and can still find it difficult to follow, although I think this time I unraveled everything that was going on. It's actually quite a simple plot, but not told in a way that's all that simple to follow. Fallen Sparrow is not a simple plot at all, and it's practically impossible to follow. Before we start looking at the movie, do you want to say anything about the Spanish Civil War backdrop and its relationship to the Popular Front?
Sure. It's such an important part of the plot. The events of the story take place in 1940, so this is before America's entry into the war, but of course the movie's from 1943. Everyone's on board with anti-fascism by 1943 in the United States. Spanish Civil War takes place from about 1936 to 1939, with some rumblings beforehand. It was a fascist coup that was launched against the legally elected leftist government.
So by a fascist coup, what do you mean?
The military.
Okay, what does this have to do with German Nazis?
Well, they were funded by Mussolini and Hitler.
Okay.
Otherwise, they could not have done what they did. It was kind of a training ground or a proving ground for the new fascist armed services. Condor Legion killed lots of people in Guernica.
I only know that because of the Picasso painting, but okay.
On the loyalist side, which was the leftist side, they were getting some funding from the Soviet Union, and they were also getting a lot of volunteer freedom fighters showing up, which is what Garfield is playing. There was a Lincoln Brigade, which was composed entirely of left-wing Americans who went to fight. That's the backdrop here. And they lost. The fascists won. Franco would wind up being in charge of Spain until he died in the mid-1970s. He actually kept Spain out of World War II, so he didn't actually fight with the Axis. And a lot of people would basically say that Franco wasn't exactly a fascist, but his funding was all fascist. He was more of a reactionary Catholic military dictator. It wasn't exactly the same political philosophy, but close enough, and certainly abhorrent to a left-winger or anyone interested in democracy or social justice. Garfield's been imprisoned and tortured in Spain by Nazis. Whatever his brigade did, they wound up killing an important Nazi official, and that's why he's being hunted, and that's why they needed him. They were questioning him. We don't find out for quite a while exactly what they were trying to get out of him, but we finally do.
Did we ever find out what his character does?
It's a very interesting backstory there, too, prior to his entry into the war, because we have some sociological placement of him. His father was a beat cop, or detective, eventually, I guess, who somehow struck it rich when Garfield was a teenager. Mm-hmm. So that's why he talks like John Garfield, but he's a member of New York's upper crust at this point.
Very weird.
It's amazing. I would love to read the novel by the same author as Ride the Pink Horse, mm-hmm. which we watched for our Joan Harrison episode.
And In a Lonely Place.
Yeah, she's a cool writer.
Looking at Garfield's filmography, this kind of seems like maybe the first noir that he did. I mean, I assume he's on loan for his leftist credentials. Most of the time, I guess his first noir that's cited is The Postman Always Rings Twice. That's not until 1945, and then he does a bunch of noirish films.
I think Out of the Fog should be considered a noir.
It's a lit back.
He plays a vicious gangster in that one, so...
Not this sweaty, psychologically afflicted type of noir character.
Honestly, I would consider The Seawolf a noir.
He's done things that are noir adjacent, and this feels the most noir adjacent yet.
Oh yeah, I think this is a straight out noir. We start with Garfield on a train talking to himself about whether he has the guts to do what he needs to do. He's reading a newspaper story about someone who has died in a mysterious accident. This is what a lot of the plot is going to hang on. Look into this death. It's a friend of his from childhood. He knows that things could not have happened the way they are purported to have happened. He's just gonna barge right in there like a lot of noir investigators do, whether they're professional investigators or not. Of course, he is not, but he's been a soldier and a combatant for many years now, so he's got some of the skills needed to wade into this kind of problem. Makes a beeline for the police station, and that's where we find out that his dad had been a cop. He introduces himself to Inspector Tobin, who knew his dad, and starts grilling these cops on why they didn't do more to figure out what really happened to this guy who is one of their own. He was on the force and was killed at this high society party. They say, just put it out of your mind. It's an accident.
I think this is only the second time I've seen this movie. I have not done a lot of thinking about it. Why are the cops covering for the fascists?
Well, we find out much later they're not, right? They are investigating it, and they've got the person that was an accomplice, the person that furnished the alibi to Otto. They've got him locked up for some other crime, and they just haven't divulged this to anyone.
This is an amazingly convoluted plot.
They're trying to get to the bottom of it. They're working working with the government as well, but they don't have the goods on these international Nazis, and so they're working up to it, and they don't want John Garfield gumming it up. They don't feel like he's ready, too, right? He's been in Arizona for a long time recovering from the psychological and physical damage that he endured in Spain. This all gets explained much, much later, right?
So it's a very convoluted plot, but you pretty much spot who the limping man is right from the beginning, so that's an easy thread to follow.
Yeah, I don't think it's meant to be a surprise. I mean, he's talking like a Nazi, even though he's supposed to be a Norwegian doctor who's a refugee and expert on torture, but he certainly relishes his disquisition on torture techniques and sounds like he's conducted many sessions himself.
Does come as a surprise to Garfield.
Well, his main antagonist is a limping man. He never saw him. He just knew this is the person that would show up from Berlin, give directives to the torturers, and then limp off again.
So he's come to associate mysterious limping sound with the torture.
And of course, it's all very subjectively filmed, and he's not sure, and we're not sure, when he's really hearing the limping and when it's just an echo of torture's past in his mind. He is much better than he was when he came back a broken man. Arizona did him some good, but he's constantly on the verge of relapsing, and for good reason. I mean, the doctors told him, no excitement.
That whole famous sequence where he's investigating in that house, and he starts to think that he's hearing the limp, and then he tries to drown it out with the sound of the street, and with, well, there's a couple
the
of
piano.
Sequences. Yeah, there's a couple of sequences, but one of them ends with him hearing the water dripping, and of course he starts thinking about Walter Slezak talking about Chinese water torture, right?
Yeah. You called this famous. Is anything in this movie famous? It should be, but...
That one I did see referenced somewhere. That sequence I did see referenced somewhere.
I still feel like this movie is not nearly given the respect it is due.
Okay, well, where I saw that referenced was a contemporary New York Times review, so I don't know how famous.
No, I really don't think it is.
It was singled out by a contemporary review.
Maybe our podcast will make it famous.
That whole sequence feels like it's located somewhere between Joseph Cotton's freakouts in I'll Be Seeing You and Joan Crawford's freakouts in Possessed.
Yeah, it's a forerunner of that stuff. I mean, it's right at the beginning of this new subjective cinema of the 1940s.
That's associated both with film noir and with the exploration of wartime PTSD.
Yeah, it's all right there. 1943, ahead of the wave of the movies that were focused on by the Cahiers people, talking about film noir. It's got voiceover, got a lot of the hallmarks. Also has a femme fatale, played by Maureen O'Hara, of all people.
Yeah.
Potential femmes fatale.
True, but pretty early on it becomes clear that Maureen O'Hara is the one we're on the lookout for, trying to figure out how associated she is with these Nazis, and whether there's any excuse for her.
And it's never quite decided.
I wasn't sure how you would read the ending. I wasn't sure how to read it myself.
I think it's ambiguous. We're pretty much told that she's lying about having a daughter that the Nazis are holding, but there could be something else. She doesn't just go foiled when she is arrested. She seems pretty broken up and is looking at the sky.
What was her relationship to the real Dr. Christian Skaz?
Well, we don't know if any of that's true, but she said, yeah, she was married to the actual...
She did say that. Could she just be being threatened with a concentration camp herself?
Well, I don't see how. She's in America now. She could get away, and that's what Garfield wants her to do, right? He wants her to just disappear, go to Chicago, he'll meet her later. And presumably they could have fixed it up to make it seem like she had died or something, right? I think that's what he was thinking of. The problem is that she gets on the plane to Lisbon to try to go get his battle standard. She overhears where he had hidden it.
Well, yeah, but then what is your explanation? What are they holding over her head, or what is this ambiguity?
No, the only ambiguity is that she doesn't play it like she is an exposed villain at the end. She plays it like she did care about him and is pretty upset about how this whole thing turned
out. So what, she's just a Nazi who fell in love with him?
On the evidence, that seems like the most likely explanation. Mm. Probably the book has more about this too. It's definitely something I'm going to explore. I don't think you need the answer though. It's kind of interesting that you don't get that. It's got some similarities to The Maltese Falcon, in fact, the way that movie
ends.
Yeah,
for sure. Did think of that. Garfield isn't quite as gleeful about sending her up as Bogart's character.
Bogart's not gleeful. He's broken up about it. He's doing his usual tough path matter while he outlines the reasons he has to send her over, but he's very upset about it. I mean, he ends by saying, maybe I'm in love with you, but it doesn't matter. You killed my partner. And, you know, same thing here. She's collaborating with the Nazis. Gotta take her away. And we never find out exactly how implicated she was in all these other things. Did she not know they were gonna kill Louis Lepetino?
Did she set up Garfield at the end?
Well, even she says, I did set you up, but you knew it was a setup, and I counted on you to get out of it. And well, that could all be true.
Sure, but he barely does.
He barely does, yeah. And it's all extremely ambiguous. Quite upsetting, the way it all plays out.
I guess I just mean there doesn't seem to be any... Despite the presence of this femme fatale, Garfield isn't kind of playing the misogyny of the noir protagonist at any point?
No, only a little bit right at the beginning, where he's talking about how Louis would only have been killed by a woman. And...
He says that because, well, he has this theory that Louis wouldn't let anyone... He would be suspicious of anyone else.
Yeah, and then he starts looking around at all the women and thinking any of them could have killed people, including Barbie and the imp.
Yeah, I'm not saying the plot doesn't have the noir misogyny. I just feel like he's not really playing it for that.
No, well, good. We don't need that.
Despite the fact that he's decisively cooled on his former socialite girlfriend who apparently lost her boner for him when she saw him in the hospital looking rough.
Yeah, that was amazing. Great reason to throw someone over. He says, you know, I thought you threw me over, and she doesn't deny it. She's like, well, yeah, you looked so awful.
So it's like the Enchanted Cottage, except that she is just, like, owning it. But you look good now. I might take you back now.
Except she's engaged to his best friend.
Well, she might take him back anyway.
That's Barbie. She's engaged to his best friend, but also going on dates with Nazis. Otto.
This Barbie goes on dates with Nazis.
Yeah, and so does the imp. You know, all the women are either Nazis themselves or dating Nazis. So he's right to be suspicious of all of them.
I mean, there's just, like, a lot of Nazis hanging around. What are you gonna do if you need a date?
It's New York, 1940. Nazis are here. They're in our midst.
They're in the upper crust, anyhow.
And Hugh Beaumont is in both movies. In this one, he plays Otto Skoss, the evil pseudo-son and bodyguard of Walter Slezak. There's also Erford Gage, who was not listed in the paragraph I read, but he's in both movies. He plays the butler, Roman, and he plays Jason the poet in The Seventh Victim.
I don't even know where Garfield is half of the time. He's in all of these different houses, apartments, spaces, and then everywhere he turns, there's a Nazi in them.
Yeah.
Or at least one.
No, it's really unsettling experience to see this movie. I remember distinctly watching it the first time. It was sometime in my teens. It came on the midnight movie. I was quite unnerved by the whole thing. It was over the Christmas holidays, sometime in the late 1980s.
So, but he's staying in a friend's apartment.
Yeah, Abner, or Ab.
Is that where he gets attacked at a certain point?
Yeah. I'm not even sure if it's the friend's apartment or if it's his apartment that the friend has been living in. It's a little unclear. They're all just a bunch of really rich people.
Who attacks him in the apartment is Anton.
Yes, Anton the piano player, and the imp loves him. He's a great accompanist and so much more, clearly. He's not a good fighter, though, but he is a Nazi. He's somehow involved with all of this. And yeah, he is the one that divulges that they're looking for this battle standard.
Well, it divulges to us, because obviously Garfield knows that. That's the whole point of all of this.
But we had no idea what the hell is going on.
And prior to that, there's a scene where Walter Slezak is there. Who's the weirdo who's making the whole big speech about the importance of battle standards?
Well, that's the fake grandfather of Maureen O'Hara. He's some kind of fascist French aristocrat, and she says later, you know, he's a sick, demented old man. He thinks the Nazis are going to make him king of France.
Right, right, right. Well, he certainly comes off that way in this scene, and this is the one where they drink out of the glasses belonging to the Borgias or something.
I love it. So good. So disturbing.
Really frenzied aristocrat.
Yeah, well, these are the kinds of people that were involved with the Croix de Feu in France.
It's hard for you to understand this sort of thing, isn't it? Yes.
The old world.
As an American. No, actually, no, not so hard to understand.
I got a thorough education. In fact, I'm the champion of guarding battle standards.
So we've got this Fifth Avenue society world that is thoroughly infiltrated by Nazis.
Fifth Avenue, Fifth Columnists.
All of whom are dating women that Garfield knows, or else are Maureen O'Hara, who he suspects is a Nazi collaborator, and that's why he's dating her, to try to find things out. Yeah, doesn't know how much he's being led on by her and played by her, but anyway, they do seem to develop feelings for each other regardless. So yeah, it's an incredibly misogynist setup, so it is all the more more interesting that despite all of the noirish features of this movie, the women don't act like femme fatales. You know what I mean? They don't act like it at all.
No, none of them are like Kitty Collins and the Killers.
No, the two women that Garfield knows just are like completely normal acting. One's a bit of a jerk, his girlfriend, and the other one, some kind of family relationship.
She's the younger cousin of his best friend, and they called her the imp when she was growing up, and now she's a blonde bombshell singer.
Right. If anything, she's like perky.
She's perky, but she is dating Anton.
Yeah.
And protecting him to some extent.
They just don't have the mannerisms of the femme fatale, and neither does Maureen O'Hara, who you would never think of being cast as a femme fatale either. Right?
No, it's all casting against type. They don't have the overt menace or the
slinky seductiveness.
No, they're all pretty straightforward with him, and he is with them as well, but there is a lot gurgling beneath the surface here. So basically, he's being used to some extent by the police. They want him to go crashing around, creating situations so that they can ferret out more information, but they don't want to let him in on what they have found out. They figure he'll start babbling it because he's crazy, because he's been tortured out of his mind.
They don't know, do they, that these Nazis are after him? Do they realize that?
I think that's true. That sort of comes as a bit of a surprise to them, but maybe not, because Louis Le Patino was a policeman and he knows all about it.
Yeah, well, he's the one who helped Garfield escape. Although Garfield finds out that he was allowed to escape.
Yeah, it's all six-dimensional chess here.
He was allowed to escape so that he would lead them to the standard, I guess?
Yeah, they realized that they could never break him under torture. They were either going to have to kill him or keep at it, and it hadn't worked in 2 years. It's never going to work. So they allow his friend to get him out of there. They allow him to send a letter. Presumably they had someone pretend that they were going to covertly get a letter out to America, but it was all carefully monitored. They let it all happen. They followed him to America, and they think that somehow it's going to come out exactly where he hid it. And that's reasonable. It sort of makes sense. Since it's not about military strategy, this is all about machismo.
Except that they kill his friend, and so he's suspicious from the time he gets to New York.
The suspicious things start happening before he even quite gets there, right? Because he runs into Maureen O'Hara on the train, and she slips Louis Le Patino's wallet into his coat. He doesn't discover it till later, and the wallet has the letter in it, so everyone has seen all of this.
Now, she says she did that to warn him. What possible other motive could she have for that?
Presumably she did it to get into his good graces so that she could get to know him better and find out where the standard is.
All right.
That's what you have to conclude by the end. But yes, most of the movie you're thinking she's being coerced. She knows a lot because she's in this milieu with these fascists and arch reactionaries, but possibly she is one as well. And she did all of this knowing that it would help to foster some kind of sense of trust between them. Very twisty, this movie.
Although then when he tries to get a date with her at her workplace, she then pretends she doesn't want to date him, despite the fact that she's already set this up between them with this wallet. It's kind of all over the place.
It is, but as we can see in practice, it works. She gives him all these different mixed signals, and finally it all adds up to, yes, I'll go out on a date with you. And it works out nicely. They're very happy together. They don't talk a lot about the nastiness going on when they're having their dates. They do some kissing and getting to know each other. Now, how much of what they're getting to know about each other is true on her side, we don't ever find out, really. But it all has the appearance of a deepening relationship in any event.
Ultimately, he tells her his motivation for keeping this standard. He says at first it was just a childish game to make them upset out of perversity, but eventually it came to, I guess, symbolize fighting Nazi evil itself.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, this is before America's entry into World War II, so it's all he can think of to do to oppose fascism globally by doing this. And it is really important to them, so it is getting to them.
These symbolic victories are important.
They are important, yeah. And I mean, and the speech that he gives is a pretty impassioned anti-fascist speech that I'm sure once again helped to get him in bad with HUAC. It's all premature anti-fascism, which is exactly what the Red Baiters were looking for in the late 1940s, and we know Garfield was raked over the coals. He never got blacklisted per se, but came pretty close, and who knows what was going to happen, and he died of a heart attack at like 40.
We've been talking a lot in our 1943 episodes about how this is the last Popular Front moment.
Well, it's the high point.
Yeah, yeah. Where they started going too far because of the war and the popularity of anti-fascism, and then the McCarthyite backlash. Whiplash came.
Yeah, so this is a very interesting RKO style popular front movie, and it's fitting that it takes place in upper crust New York society. It's every bit as anti-fascist as Mission to Moscow,
right,
in its way.
Because that's their audience.
Exactly.
It's often what their movies were about in the 30s.
Yeah, sophisticated. That's the RKO hallmark.
And now John Garfield is one of those sophisticates, one of those Fifth Avenue guys.
A real casting coup, I think. Did the father win the lottery, or did he inherit a huge amount of money from someone, some relative one was aware of?
Yeah, exactly. Why would he be a cop if he had a relative like that?
Well, maybe it was a fluke and it wasn't an expected inheritance, right? Maybe everyone else that was in line for it died.
Maybe he was actually supposed to be the new king of France.
Maybe.
Yeah, he was the 100th in line and everybody else died.
So Garfield has some great lines in this movie, some amazing opportunities to suffer on camera and experience anxiety. I really enjoy his exit line when he first visits the cops and asks whether his gun permit is still valid, even though the person that got it for him is dead. And they're like, what do you want a gun for? And he's like, to kill people with, sweetheart.
Right.
A real loose cannon on the streets of New York and in the drawing rooms of New York. Barbie's parties, a lot of things happen there that are suspect. And of course, that's going to be a motif that carries over into Seventh Victim. So many of the anxieties and settings carry over.
What do you think of specifically?
Posh parties where very sinister things are happening in both. And just this real sense of unease and uncertainty about pretty much everyone's motives, except for Garfield, and in Seventh Victim, really, except for Kim Hunter. I mean, everyone else is kind of ambiguous for a lot of that movie.
True.
So they're asking a lot of audiences. They're asking for audiences to really watch everybody and try to figure out who can be trusted and who can't and what's being covered up.
Yeah, and who's involved with the witches and who isn't.
We have to talk about Walter Slezak in this movie. Such a varied career, too, because we've discussed him before. He was a leading man, and we actually saw him in the early 30s in a leading man part in Music in the Air. Somewhere along the way, he got a character actor body type going, wound up, you know, really delivering some dominant character performances in the 40s. This is a great one. Played a Nazi a few times, like Once Upon a Honeymoon, and also Lifeboat.
Oh, right. We saw him in Michael as Dorian Gray type beloved young man.
That's right. We've seen many phases of Slezak's career. I really like him as a lovable old scientist type guy, too, like in Bedtime for Bonzo.
So here he's just the full mad Nazi doctor.
Or Nazi sociologist, or historian of torture, or whatever he is. I mean, he's some kind of high-up party member.
But he's experimenting with his drug. The way this whole scene is shot, he and Garfield finally confront each other without the masks. He's filling up that syringe after he's already drugged Garfield. I don't know if he's going to give him another dose, or Garfield looks pretty heavily drugged already. But the way it's filmed and the iconography is very pulp novel slash comic book.
Yeah, and it has some echoes, too, again, of the Maltese Falcon. They were definitely drawing inspiration from it. It is an original take.
Well, of course, the Maltese Falcon, what's interesting about that, the 1941 Maltese Falcon is, it's not very visually noir.
No, that's true.
And this very heavily is.
Richard Wallace, can't say enough about the impact this movie makes. So much of it, yes, he has some great assistants, but he's the one orchestrating all of it. And I don't have a good handle on his career, but I love a lot of his movies. I mean, he directed The Little Minister.
He's certainly no kind of auteur. He's just one of those directors who will direct whatever he's given.
Some real classics.
In all sorts of different genres.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, they're not all this good, but...
Well, he doesn't seem like a hack.
No, definitely not. No, there are a lot of great movies on that filmography if you look it over.
Yeah, I guess I would say, looking at these two RKO noirs, we can call them, and comparing them to the later Warner Brothers classic noirs, that Opacity, RKO is willing to go much further with Opacity.
Eddie Muller always calls them the House of Noir. So certainly will be important fare for the studio for the rest of the 1940s.
I mean, Opacity, there's lots of very convoluted noir plots, obviously. Murder, My Sweet is pretty convoluted. And
that's RKO.
There you go, RKO again. Whereas when Howard Hawks does The Big Sleep, he just, obviously is very convoluted, but he also just doesn't care and doesn't make that important to the movie, right?
Yeah, it's a slightly different approach for sure. RKO really likes to lean into that atmosphere of absolute uncertainty and make it a selling point of these films. And Crossfire certainly has that too. And when it comes down to it, Out of the Past. Anyway, if you have not seen the movie, I hope we haven't spoiled it for you. I don't think it's a movie that can be spoiled.
We spoil every movie.
You need to see this movie.
You need to see every movie.
And if you can't find it, just let us know, as always. Onward to our second feature. Once again, we go to Richard B. Jewell and Vernon Harbin, the RKO story. Devil worship was the subject of The Seventh Victim, another experiment in psychological terror from the fertile imaginations of Val Lewton and his B-Unit cohorts. The Charles O'Neill, DeWitt Bodine screenplay called for neophyte Kim Hunter to stumble upon a satanic cult while searching for her sister, Jean Brooks, who has disappeared into the bowels of Greenwich Village. Former editor Mark Robson, boosted into the director's chair by producer Lewton, displayed a flair for suspense and a feel for shuddery atmosphere, but revealed his inexperience by muddying the narrative with multiple confusions. Alright, we'll see how we react to that. Befuddled audiences decided the picture was horrible rather than horrific and made it the least successful of Lewton's initial cycle. They probably didn't even notice the staircase from the Magnificent Ambersons used in the first scene. Tom Conway again received top billing in the familiar guise of a psychiatrist, while Isabel Jewell, Evelyn Brent, Erford Gage, Ben Bard, Hugh Beaumont, Chef Milani, Margarita Silva, Mary Newton, Wally Brown, and Fyodor Charliapin had supporting roles. Well, how do you like that, Elise?
This is your favorite Lewton, isn't it?
This is the best Lewton movie, there's no doubt.
Okay.
There's so many good ones, but this is the ultimate.
I'm pretty fond of Curse of the Cat People.
Me too, but if I had to pick one, this would be it. There are no missteps made here. Everything is done on purpose.
Of course. I always liked this one, but I had never heard anyone as enthusiastic as you about it before I met you.
One little thing I noticed, actually, I've always talked about this as a proto Mulholland Drive.
Well, it's a proto a lot of things, so we can talk to that.
I had never noticed there's someone in the cast named Wally Brown. Wally Brown is a character in Mulholland Drive. He's the producer, James Caron. We love having you on the set. You know, he's the grandfatherly guy that is overseeing the audition.
Oh, interesting. Okay, so definitely direct reference. I thought about Mulholland Drive watching this. I thought about Shadow of a Doubt, which is certainly a Lynch-influenced film. And, of course, there are both the sister who searches for her troubled other sister and the shower scene are obviously stolen by Hitchcock for Psycho.
Yes.
Very influential film here.
Everyone that loves this movie made great movies. Except for me.
So, you never made any movies. The New York milieu in this film is not Fifth Avenue, it's Greenwich Village, but treated in a similar way.
But we see some of the same sets.
We see some of the same sets, and we once again see the Magnificent Amberson set, I guess, as in Cat People. Lewton just kept reusing it.
It's the gift that keeps on giving, the set that keeps on setting.
Recoup the loss from that film somehow, I guess. The story goes that DeWitt Bodine, under orders from Lewton, got hooked up with an actual devil-worshipping group from the west side of Manhattan. I have no idea if this is true or not, but this is the story that was told. RKO found one and got in touch with them. He claimed they were a bunch of little old ladies.
They're like evil Unitarians.
A bunch of little old ladies who were knitting while trying to cast spells, satanic spells, on Adolf Hitler.
Sounds like a useful thing to do, really.
And again, another great horror movie comes out of this movie, obviously. I don't know whether it was directly an influence on Polanski or if it was influence on Ira Levin, the writer of Rosemary's Baby. But regardless, the banality of Satanism as portrayed in this movie is an obvious influence on Rosemary's Baby. In fact, DeWitt Bodine's actual Satanists, if they existed, seem more like the Rosemary's Baby Satanists even than the people we meet in this movie. But yeah, just completely ordinary, everyday people who have decided that this is a reasonable thing to do.
There's no mention of the war in this movie, right? It's taking place in 1943, I guess, but we're just in a weird siloed off America. I mean, Kim Hunter is our viewpoint character, and she's got a lot to think about. The war just never enters into it.
As with Cat People, because we did that quite recently on the podcast, you really have to grapple with what is the metaphor in this movie? What is it trying to say? There's definitely overlap with the portrayal of Irena in that movie and Jacqueline in this movie, right? And in the way that the nice girl, the ordinary girl, is brought even more to the forefront in this movie and becomes the protagonist. Jacqueline becomes almost a kind of mythic figure in the background.
Yeah, first time you're watching it, you could easily think, well, she's never going to show up, is she? And when she does, all she does is hold her finger up to shush her sister and disappears again.
Silencio!
However, she does take over the protagonist role for a while in the second half of the movie.
True.
There's so much going on in 70 minutes.
But this is one of your favorite movies, Dave, so I need you to talk to me about what you think the message and metaphor are.
I'm not sure it can be reduced to...
Well, I think we have to talk about the meaning of the movie.
As you say, it's about inquiry. Once you look into anything that is confusing you, you're almost certain to find things that are disturbing.
So let's talk about how it's set up. Mythic or fairy tale structure.
Yeah, we start out in a kind of weird girls' school.
Well, it looks like a...
Bronte school.
Or a Catholic school, because of the way that they're talking about it being a refuge, a place to hide from the world.
And there's stained glass.
Yeah, that helps.
She's presumably been living a very sheltered life off by herself over here. She's an adult, basically, but she's still at the school. She gets called into the principal's or the head teacher or the owner of the school.
Headmistress.
They tell her, well, you're no longer a paying pupil. Your sister has disappeared and it's been 6 months. So that's the bad news. The good news is you can stay and be a teacher or assistant. She's like, what are you talking about? My sister's missing. To go find her. I'm like, oh, well, I guess kind of figured you might do that. And they advance her the money.
Mm-hmm.
It's very interesting because there's a kind of sinister air hovering over all of this, but everything they do, everything this headmistress does is kind of sympathetic. When they leave the audience with this headmistress, the younger member of the faculty tells her, don't come back. If you do, you're basically giving up on life like I did.
Yeah, she says, I was afraid of life or whatever. It takes courage to face life and I didn't have it. So I came back.
And that actress plays the teacher in Curse of the Cat People, too.
So the idea here is if you go out in life, go mix in the real world, you're going to discover terrible things that you will need courage to face.
And not everyone's gonna be able to face
them. Jacqueline can't face them in her own way, obviously.
And that's very much part of the Lewton philosophy, right? The world is horrible and it's gonna break a lot of people or most of them or almost everyone. Honestly, is it worth continuing to live?
In Cat People, we said in our podcast episode where I came up with new thoughts about it that I hadn't had before, we agreed that Irena's problem, the meaning, the metaphor of this terrible superpower that she has, or she turns into a cat if she gets sexually aroused or possessive or upset, feels passion. The metaphor of it is that she is afflicted with dark knowledge against her will. Some people just have this knowledge of the terrible depths of life. And the husband and girl from work that he falls in love with, these nice people, they don't have that. And it's just fate that you have it or you don't have it. And the ones who are spared it are very lucky. But nothing could ever possibly make them understand it.
No.
Right?
And that's, I mean, Hugh Beaumont is the Kent Smith character in this one.
But this is different because Mary is going to try to understand these things even though she is not afflicted by them the way that Jacqueline is.
Yeah, and that's why she's such a rich protagonist, because she is super resilient. Ultimately, nothing really gets her down and she survives all of this. As you say, she's not trying to seal herself off from any of it. I mean, she takes the advice to heart in a way that people rarely take advice to heart. She really goes out there to wade into life to find out what it's really all about and whether she can deal with it. She makes a lot of friends along the way who assist her. There's the poet, Jason. There's so many weird, interesting things. Maybe Jewel and Harbin consider this clumsy. I find it just adds to the atmosphere. If you're gonna love this movie as much as I do, a test case scene would be we go to the Dante restaurant. Jason says, do you really want to find your sister? And the co-owner of the restaurant laughs uproariously and says, Jason, he's a good boy, but he makes everything into a joke. joke. And he's like, I'm a good boy, but it feels like someone missed a line or something, right? Because he didn't say a joke. He asked seriously, are you sure you really want to find out what happened to your sister? Such insane dissonance. Nobody understands why she's laughing, and the audience joins in the confusion, I think.
Well, later on, he says that she has some kind of weird association between poetry and humor that that nobody else has.
Exactly.
Apparently, the way this was written was there was a story by DeWitt Bodine, and then it was totally rewritten by Charles O'Neill, and then DeWitt Bodine gave that another pass, and then Val Lewton totally rewrote it.
It's so good.
Definitely very deliberate.
So odd, right? And if you love that, then you're gonna love everything in this movie, I think, because it just throws so many curveballs at you, and it feels like there are things missing all over the place, and that's by design.
Well, that's very Mulholland Drive.
Exactly.
Sure. What is the first thing that Mary discovers when she goes out into the world?
Well, when she goes to visit the people at the restaurant, you know, they also have some rooms that they rent. She doesn't really describe her all that thoroughly, but they're like, oh, la bellissima Madonna.
It says something about her sister being very beautiful with dark hair and tall. Of course, when we actually meet Jean Brooks, she's this tiny little woman who's like smaller than Kim Hunter, but
she just makes a big impression. Well, she convinces them, and this is one of the first of many times where she just exerts her will. She manages to make people do what she wants them to do. After refusing to go look in this room that Jacqueline has rented in their place, we cut to them going in and opening it, and they find behind the door a totally empty room with a chair and a noose hanging from the ceiling.
And this is the kind of horror, this is not normal horror from a studio era Hollywood film, or any era of Hollywood film, which is just...
Or any era of any film.
The horror of somebody contemplating killing themselves.
She finds out through other channels, the person making an inquiry about Jacqueline was this lawyer, played by Hugh Beaumont, later the dad on Leave It to Beaver.
Now, as with Kent Smith, this lawyer character, I mean, he ends up with Kim Hunter. As with Kent Smith and Jane Randolph in Cat People, Mary is a much more interesting character than this lawyer character.
Sure.
In this case, it feels a little unfortunate to me that they end up together.
Yeah, I don't find that Hugh Beaumont, he doesn't have the same moments that Ken Smith is given. You know, the moment that I love where he talks about how he's never been unhappy and breaks down. We don't see anything like that from...
No, he's just boring.
Yeah. Again, I think the movie wants you to feel a little bit like, ah, really? This is who Kim Hunter's gonna wind up with? He's not a bad guy.
Well, the movie just doesn't pay any attention to him. It's more interested in every other character, which is why I think you are left kind of wishing she'd get together with this poet, but she doesn't, because the poet is too masochistic.
Yeah, the poet is just eager to push her into the arms of anyone else so that he can suffer some more.
Some people think of this as a prequel to Cat People because Tom Conway is playing the Dr. Judd character again. But this is just an alternate universe, obviously, because Dr. Judd is a complete idiot in Cat People, and here he's still a kind of a jerk, but he has some finer moments.
He does. Justice for Dr. Judd.
Yeah, it's an alternate universe where he's resurrected. Justice for Dr. Judd.
Vernon Harbin and Richard Jewell say that he's playing a familiar character, a psychiatrist. It's the same character. They don't mention that. I don't understand why.
But it's also not the same character.
No, he just has the same name.
It's not a prequel.
No, this is another dimension of the Lewton verse, and that's how you have to think of it. And it's certainly one where we get to see a more varied portrait of Lewis Judd.
So what's going on here? Try to unknot this plot a little bit. We find out that Jacqueline is this flighty sensation seeker who is always trying out new things, trying to find some meaning in her life.
But she's a successful business owner, an entrepreneur. We have to keep that in mind. So
true.
Can't be that flighty, or she can't have been that flighty when she was running a business, but somehow things have gotten completely off track with her.
It turns out that her manager, you have to put all this together by the end of the movie, because it's not presented in any kind of linear fashion, but her manager gets her involved in Satanism.
Yeah.
And this seems to her initially to be just the thing, but as with all other things that she's tried, eventually it loses its luster, but she finds that this is one hobby she's adopted that she can't easily extricate herself from.
No, it's like the mob. Once you're in, you can't get out. Yeah, some really interesting extracurricular team building activities going on at this perfume company and beauty parlor. They're going to Satanist club meetings after dark.
There is some kind of suggestion of a possible lesbian infatuation or relationship between her and the younger woman who works there.
Yes, the great Isabel Jewell. We've seen her in a lot of movies. She always has at least one highlight scene where she can completely pull out all the stops. She played the seamstress in Tale of Two Cities. Great actress, very interesting character here too. She's just this very kind person who somehow got sucked into going to the Satanist meetings too, and like everyone else, she can't get out now. We first meet Hugh Beaumont, and he says, oh, don't worry about that noose, I can explain that to you. Jacqueline just had a theory that life wasn't worth living unless you knew that you could end it at any time. He says, well, I didn't really understand it, but it, you know, it's okay, don't worry about it. She's not suicidal.
He also says people who talk about suicide don't commit it, which I'm not sure if that's true, and it definitely does not turn out to be true in this movie.
No, he's wrong. It's just really interesting the way he tries to normalize it.
Well, like Kent Smith, he obviously got infatuated with this woman sexually somehow, but then immediately regretted it the way she regretted her Satanism. He's married to her, and
he's hired detectives to find her.
And he believes in this commitment, so he can't get out easily either.
Louis Judd shows up because he is Cupid's messenger.
This is where Jacqueline's story continues. She goes to Judd. This is how she betrays the Satanists. And the reason she must die, she goes to Judd to
sort her life out. You know, why do I do things like join a Satanist society? She's broken their rules.
Their rules of secrecy, even though he has his own professional rules of secrecy. There's a question of whether he's sleeping with her, and I think that is ambiguous. And we know from cat people it's the sort of thing he would do.
Sure. She's not that different.
He just has one moment of grace in this movie, that's all. His relationship with the poet. But he knows the Satanists too? Does he know them just to hang out with them? I don't understand how she betrayed them if he also knows them.
Well, there are people who are known about town. I think that's the idea. And he wouldn't have known that they were a Satanist club until Jacqueline told him.
So you think he priorly socialized with these people and then found out they were Satanists through her?
Because we see two gatherings at the same place, right? Hosted by Evelyn Brent both times, the silent film star. She's got a small role in this one.
We know her from Sternberg movies.
There's one promiscuous gathering. It's not all Satanists at that party, right? And then when they're gathered again, it's only the Satanists, and they're trying to make Jacqueline kill herself.
Because the poet knows them too.
Yeah, everyone knows everyone. It's Greenwich Village. It's a small world.
And this movie is considered a love letter of Lewton's to Greenwich Village.
Well, it's beautiful, and it's very evocative, there's no doubt.
So what are we saying about Greenwich Village here? It's the kind of place where people try out all kinds of new ideas and some of them don't work.
And there's also a lot of nice cozy spots to hang out in. I mean, the Dante is a great little restaurant, great little neighborhood hangout, and it was an Italian neighborhood, right? So there are lots of checker tablecloth Italian restaurants in Greenwich Village at the time, so all of that is part of the village atmosphere.
What do you think it is saying about Greenwich Village, though? It is a place where you can go to the extremes of trying to find out things about life.
Sure, and they might break you or be the making of you as a more interesting human being and possibly a great poet, even.
These devil worshippers are called Paladists, which I had to look up. Turns out that this is a reference. Paladism specifically refers to Pallas Athena, therefore to neo-paganism.
So they're Wiccans?
No, not exactly. The reference is to a fake Satanist group that was a hoax perpetuated, but I mean, you know, referring to possibly to actual neo-paganist movements at the time. It was an anti-clerical hoax perpetuated by Leo Taxil in the 1880s, a free thinker. It was a hugely elaborate hoax in which he enlisted actors to pretend to be people who had actual knowledge of this cult. He was damning Freemasons as Satanists in order to play into Catholic fears of Freemasons so that he could show how gullible and stupid Catholics are.
Okay. Well, we've still got a lot of talk about the Illuminati and the Masons today, so I'm sure he'd be happy.
Yeah, it all sounds very QAnon-ish, and this guy was Q.
An amazing set piece when she goes to the missing persons bureau. Camera pans down along the counter. We see all of these people talking about their lost loved ones. It's quite an upsetting vignette. The camera lights on Kim Hunter at the end as she tries to interest the police in pursuing her own sister's disappearance.
And then she meets this weird little man.
Yeah, played by character actor Lou Lubin, who was in a few Thin Man movies. I love this character, Irving August. Very soft-spoken. I mean, he's tiny. He's a detective, and he's very confident. He tells her that all she has to do is give him $50 and he's going to be able to locate her sister. But he doesn't seem to know much about who her sister is, and he gets warned off it.
Just like her, his reaction to being warned off something is to decide he must pursue it.
So he shows up again later, and she says, look, I have no money. And he says, no, I'm going to do it. Pretty sure I know. I did some legwork already. I went to La Sagesse, the beauty company. They let him tour the facilities, but there was one room they wouldn't let him into.
So we've got our second secret room already.
And she's like, well, let's go there right now. You want to go there right now? That's dangerous. And she's like, let's go. We could go right now. I mean, Kim Hunter is a great actor right at the beginning of her career.
She is. This is her first film, and it's before her Paul Pressburger films, and it's also long before her Streetcar Named Desire stage performance.
This indomitable will that she has. This character, the ingenue, who nevertheless is also kind of a master of the universe in a way.
Well, she commits her act of evil here.
Exactly. The thing about her, of course, that makes us like her all the more is that she realizes when she's done something horrible.
Well, she sends this man to his death out of her own cowardice.
Yeah, you could go on, Mr. August.
Her own cowardice and curiosity.
Talking in an ingenue voice, but yeah, ordering a man to his death.
Kim Hunter definitely, yeah, she's playing an ingenue here, but she has a very hard quality, a very solid quality to her as an actress.
She's got a lot of the parts we will see broken down in Mulholland Drive and Naomi Watts characters. I mean, she's really that complicated, I think.
Well, she is Jacqueline's sister.
The way that sequence is shot is incredible. The noirish corridor, the secret room. It's all so slow. I mean, it's not an action movie, of course. Very suspenseful, very unsettling watching all of these things happen. And everything happens quietly, even a stabbing to death. Irving August,
no, there's no sound.
Just stumbles back out, walking very gingerly along the hallway, and she doesn't realize. She's like, why aren't you telling me what happened in there? Finally, he just falls over dead on his stomach, which has been carved out with
scissors, it turns out.
She gets on the subway and just rides back and forth.
This seems like Nascent De Palma scene.
Absolutely. Dewey Robinson, I think, is that actor's name? He's a Sturges guy, and he's also in a lot of Lewton movies.
Yeah, there's a Dewey Robinson as conductor.
Yeah. So he asks her, you know, you okay, lady? You've been going back and forth on the subway. Hope you've been enjoying the ride. This is the authority figure. He goes off to another car, and meanwhile, they cross back over the 14th Street station. Enough time has passed that the Pilatists have been able to put their cover-up into effect. They've got Mr. August, these two guys. They're pretending that they're shouldering a drunk, but he is, in fact, dead. She's got her own problems. She's preoccupied, but she can't ignore when Irving's hat falls off and she sees his dead face. She runs into the next car to tell Dewey what's been happening, but by then it's too late. There's the sinister scene where she looks back and they're not drunk anymore, right? So they know the jig is up, they get off the train and presumably throw him into the river or do whatever they need to do so that no one ever finds him. She tries to tell Hugh Beaumont about this and he's like, fine, no one else is gonna believe you, so we're gonna have to figure something else out. That's one of the key scenes too. Maybe my favorite scene. I don't know. There's so many great scenes, but he tells her to drink her milk. And she's like, I don't like people telling me what to do. Her reaction to being patronized that way is one of the great moments in cinema history, I feel. So strangely powerful and yet understated, like so much of this film. And he is suitably chastised. I mean, he gets the message. That's it. Sorry, I've been treating you like a child.
But he does say that he will take charge sometimes.
And in this case, fine. He got her a job. Fair enough. She's happy to learn that there is a kindergarten class that needs her weird assistance, as we see later as she sings them songs about chopping people's heads off.
Yeah, she's definitely implicated in the dark side.
Yeah, but she bears it all with a smile. Jason, the poet, declares his love for her and undertakes submission. He's failed in everything else in his life, he says, but in this he will not fail. He is going to find Jacqueline.
There's a woman in his past who seems to have maybe been related to his writer's block or his refusal to get published or something.
He published a book 10 years ago, which was a huge success. He lost this relationship, saw this woman in the company of Louis Judd.
So Louis Judd is potentially framed as some kind of sinister figure here. And
seducer.
Worse than that, if she disappeared forever. And if we've seen cat people, that might also support that idea.
Well, and he's doing everything he can to make people think he's a villain, too. He talks about going up the left-hand staircase, the sinister side.
Right, and also he's preventing Jacqueline's husband from seeing her, but then he decides that he will let her sister see her.
Yeah, I mean, presumably he doesn't think Hugh Beaumont can help. He doesn't think she wants to see him. I mean, that's what you have to assume by the end of all of this, that he really has been taking his responsibility to her as a patient seriously.
Yeah, except that he's also kind of living with her. That seems to be going a little bit far.
Well, that's how Judd works. When he has a case that interests him, he goes whole hog. He tells the secretary, again, one of the early scenes where we meet him, he's just having a casual conversation with Hugh Beaumont's secretary, and she is trying to get some professional advice from him.
Well, he's written about dipsomania, but
he no longer gets involved with such sordid matters, and that's how he puts it. Dipsomania is so sordid.
Lots of people can help you with that. I'm more specialized now. I only like glamorous Satanists.
So yeah, I mean, he really doesn't come off well in that scene. This poor secretary, like, she's got a real problem. Her dad is a drunk. He just thinks that's sordid. Don't bother me with those details. But yeah, Jason has some good ideas. I mean, he goes right to Natalie Cortez's salon and confronts those people.
Yeah, Kim Hunter really doesn't come up with anything on her own. She just inspires all these men to come up with investigative ideas.
Well, she's pulling the strings. Then he gets a real brainwave. He's like, okay, Louis Judd's involved somehow, and Mrs. Reddy is involved as well, the woman who took over the beauty salon.
Who has gifted it.
Yes.
I don't know if that was in an attempt to make them stop coming after her or what.
Well, no, we find out that none of that was Jacqueline's doing. They just imprisoned her and took the place. So he goes to the library, and there he charms the librarian, works his sweet talk on her, and gets access to both of their library cards. What a wonderful time when everyone did go to the public library. He tells her, you know, I want to find out what to get them for their birthdays.
Now we would just look up this symbol on the internet, probably.
He finds that they've both been reading books on devil worshippers. And he's like, well, a psychiatrist, that's normal. But what's this beauty salon entrepreneur reading about Satanists for?
It's a really super chilling moment later after Kim Hunter gets her hair done and starts asking questions there. Afterwards, the owner confronts the young woman who was doing her hair, and she just says, you fool, that symbol, it's us!
Yeah, but who is the real fool? If this is a secret symbol, why did Mrs. Reddy put it on all of their perfume bottles? Why did she make it their corporate logo?
I don't know, I guess it's to make her beauty parlor ultra powerful.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, she's the fool. She declared it to the world, right?
But it's us, I don't know, there's just something...
Oh yeah, it's amazing.
Chilling about that wording.
But I feel like Isabel Jewell has been unfairly blamed for divulging a secret that was there for all to see. It's just that she happens to pick up a perfume bottle and say, look, here it is. Here's the symbol.
Well, for anyone who's taking out devil-worshipping books from the library, yes.
And doodling on the books, doodling the Satan symbol on it. It's all Reddy's fault. She's the architect of her own doom here. But that's the inciting scene, right? She's like, okay, no, Kim Hunter knows too much. I'm going to go do the psycho shower scene with her now. And that is just incredibly crazy. And of course, in 1943 would have been even more unsettling. I can't imagine there had ever been a Hollywood movie filmed like this. Kim Hunter is taking a shower. This shadow seeps into the room.
And this older woman with this sort of cultured voice
He's like, don't trouble. I just have a message for you. Your sister is a murderer, so you better stop making inquiries.
The sinister implications of some obscure form of violence that could be used against her in this vulnerable position.
You just feel defenseless when you have no clothes on.
The whole shower scene in Psycho, which I'm sure nothing like that was in the Robert Bloch novel. Yeah, this is the genesis of it right here.
It would be my guess too, but Robert Bloch aficionados can tell us if we're wrong there.
I don't think there's anything like the Marion Crane plot in that novel, from what I remember anyway.
You read it?
No, but I read about it.
Reddy speaks to someone right after that and says, yeah, don't worry about Kim Hunter anymore. I fixed that. And she's actually right. Mary is ready to give up because she does not want to push things any further and get her sister arrested or executed. However, when she does confide in people, they talk her out of it. So it's good that she has the support group around her. She goes to visit Jason the Poet, and here we see his apartment, which is the apartment in The Fallen Sparrow. It's got this amazing skylight, just, you know, the classic bohemian Greenwich Village pad. And why isn't Jason happy? He should be. He's living it up. But she comes and says goodbye, and he's like, goodbye? Don't you have anything more to say to me than that? I thought we were friends. She starts to divulge what she knows. Everyone is basically like, no, we have to go get Jacqueline now. Have her turn herself in. She's not responsible. Even if she did kill Irving August, she was kept like an animal in a room for ages. And what do you expect? She lashed out crazy at the first person that burst in there. That's not first degree murder.
So this is a connection between the sisters when we finally see Jacqueline in this scene with the Satanist, because she is also refusing to drink.
Oh yeah.
She doesn't want to be told when she will kill herself, even if she does want to kill herself.
Jean Brooks does an amazing job. This whole scene is so tense. And again, there's no violence. It's...
Well, their founder, whoever the hell that was.
Oh man, that guy's creepy as hell.
Their founder counseled non-violence, but also that anyone who betrays them must die.
He's like, there must have been some genius in it when they imposed these contradictory injunctions upon us. It's all about punishing yourself. And that's what they've been trying to do. They imprisoned her so that she could think about what she's done and finally kill herself, because that's what she deserves. And she should come to that realization herself.
Or at least, like, the horror of it to me is that there's this entire group of people who want her to die. They're just going to keep telling her that forever, that she ought to die until she just wants to die.
They're putting every bit of pressure they can on her without touching a hair on her head, although they are kidnapping her. They have no qualms about that. Apparently the founder said nothing about that. That doesn't count as violence. To me, that's violence, but I guess that's splitting hairs. So they're all just gathered around, and she's just like, no, I won't do it.
She moans it out a few times, too.
Almost no words in this movie, but it's an indelible performance.
This is the thing, because I always thought you were quite crazy for fixating on that milk moment, but the movie's position of power is this negation. It seems to be the only thing that you can offer the world is this negation.
Yeah.
Whatever that means.
Fuck you, I won't do what you told me.
Jacqueline's power, because she does have this fear of life, is that she will choose her own time and place to die, basically. Yeah.
So it does start to fall in place, and that's, I guess, how Hugh Beaumont came to feel like, yeah, it's okay. It's not as creepy as it seems. She's just setting this up in case she needs to kill herself. She's got a place to do it in. However, she does reach her breaking point when her pal, Isabel Jewell, freaks out and can't handle it anymore and just says, drink it, Jacqueline, you've got to drink it. And she does. She reaches for the goblet. However, at that point, Isabel Jewell takes it all back and just smashes the goblet out of her hands. She both brings about the crisis and then prevents it from reaching its horrible climax.
Now, this guy who follows Jacqueline when she leaves with the knife, do you think they have just hired someone to kill her, or is he just a random psycho?
It's not entirely clear.
They've just decided to defy the rules of the founder?
That doesn't seem right.
They did say to her that we'll find another way, though.
Yeah, and maybe he didn't actually even mean to kill her, just scare her within an inch of her life so that she'd rather just go kill herself instead of...
Well, so it works.
Exactly. I mean, this scene is incredible too, where she's rambling through the night. Just like the way they're like, okay, well, we're not going to pour another goblet of poison and try to make you drink it. The mood is dead now, so go home. this is not the end of it. You don't belong in life anymore. Having her kill Irving August is just another item on the ledger that makes it seem like maybe it is a good idea to kill herself. What can she look forward to? Maybe a manslaughter trial or being put in an asylum for...
Well, she is very, very neurotic and seems to hate life.
So it's rough. But she does not want to go on their terms.
Clearly, she's been trying to find some way to enjoy her life, and it's not working. But she tells this woman that she confronts...
Elizabeth Russell, yes.
This woman is...
Tuberculosis, I guess.
Yeah, is dying and doesn't want to die, and she's afraid to die. But Jacqueline tells her Jacqueline, has always wanted to die. So what is going on with her there?
The only thing that seems to have been anchoring her to life is her love for her sister, because she almost seems like she's brought back from the brink when she sees Mary.
Well, they're supposedly close. She's the one who raised Mary, but at the same time, Mary isn't even surprised when she doesn't write to her for 6 months. She says, well, she doesn't write that often. So
yeah.
It's all, this whole background and this relationship is very ambiguous.
Did you notice, by the way, since we saw La Boheme so recently, we've got the dying Mimi, that's her name.
True. Obviously, that's...
It's got to be a reference.
Deliberate reference, yeah.
And so they both basically decide that it's time to go. I mean, Jacqueline decides she's going to have to hang herself. Mimi decides, I'm going to go out on the town and enjoy myself and therefore die because I'm going to overtax my system.
Well, Jacqueline kind of says to her, well, she does say to her, you're just going to die anyway.
Yeah, may as well have fun.
Well, no, when Jacqueline says that to her, she doesn't mean may as well have fun. She means no matter what you do, no matter how much you enjoy your life, it's going to end in death. So it's kind of the fact that she wants death, but she is also overwhelmed with fear of it, because it's kind of the fact that everything ends in death that renders everything meaningless and makes her want to die.
Yeah. I mean, it's the cause of depression, and in some moods, she feels like it's the answer as well. It's an irresolvable conundrum.
So her life is death haunted, and that is the reason that she wants to die. Every attempt to have life is just haunted by death.
And of course, this is at back of so many human anxieties. You know, in one form or another, we're worried about this.
Of course. What are these Satanists up to? What is going on with them? There's a very silly moment where...
I love it.
Where the Satanists are shamed by the Lord's Prayer. It's very, very silly. I feel like it's stuck in there for the production code. Although I don't know why you would need to emphasize that Satanists are bad, because these Satanists are trying to torture this woman into killing herself.
If we prefer to believe in satanic majesty, who are you to judge? But Louis Judd, yes, delivers the homily.
They all look very ashamed of themselves, like bad little girls and boys. Yes, the power of those words is so great that even we, the Satanists, feel them.
Well, they must, right? Because why else are they worshiping Satan?
Okay, well, this is what I was going to say. Historically, Satanism has, you know, until the 1960s, when there was an actual Church of Satanism founded in America.
Anton LaVey.
Yeah. Was more often a false accusation against groups than an actual thing, way more often. If you are going to practice devil worship, there's only a couple of things it can be. One is that you're not actually worshiping evil, you're just worshiping things that have been called evil by Christianity, say. Sex or fertility or the will to power or all those sorts of things. Creativity, all sorts of things associated with satanic or Luciferian imagery, right? Saying that Milton was of the devil's party without knowing it when he wrote Paradise Lost.
Yeah.
Could include revolutionary ism, or you're just inverting Christianity, which means you're just a Christian who's rebelling against Christianity.
Yeah.
There's nothing else you can be doing.
Yeah, Christianity is the key, and that's why the Lord's Prayer has an impact in that scene.
So these are actual evil Satanists, so you have to imagine that that's what they've done. They've inverted Christianity.
And they are naughty, and that's how they like to think of themselves. And Dr. Judd has discerned all of that and delivered the sermon. And it's just wonderful that it's Tom Conway giving this, because of course it's the last thing you'd expect Dr. Judd to say.
Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
I mean, he's been led into temptation in the Lewton movies that we've seen. He knows whereof he speaks.
I mean, we get this whole journey of Mary's, but then, as you say, the protagonist duties are handed over to Jacqueline, and it ends on Jacqueline, and I don't know that we really see, other than she's going to marry this boring lawyer, that we really see how things conclude for Mary.
No, and of course that's by design too. Yeah, I mean, things are set up in such a way that we get this confession of love from Hugh Beaumont and she reciprocates, but they talk about how, you know, how's this going to work? I mean, we're trying to get Jacqueline acquitted of this murder she's committed. They're all working so hard. Meanwhile, Beaumont doesn't want her anymore. He's fallen in love with Mary. Mary's in love with him. But there's so much angst there and we never get to see the catharsis. Well, the thing that is going to solve all of their problems, Jacqueline just killing herself. And that's another reason why she is kind of the hero of the movie, because she, I'm sure, sees that it will make everything easier for everyone. It's like Jimmy Stewart in It's a Wonderful Life, but it's the right decision to kill herself.
Also, Irina at the end of Cat People also takes herself out of the picture so the other two can get together.
Very much in that vein, yeah. But yeah, we don't get to see them say, oh, we can marry now. Jacqueline's dead. She's out of her misery.
Shadow of a Doubt also ends with Teresa Wright marrying that boring, or being set up to marry that boring detective.
McDonald Carey, yeah.
And they just talk about how...
Sometimes people go crazy.
Yeah, just go a little crazy.
Yeah, that's also 1943. It's got so many great parts to it, but it's not like the parts are greater than the sum. The sum is somehow even more magnificent because it's got all of these different jigsaw pieces that don't necessarily all fit together, but they're all incredible and they're designed not to fit together perfectly so that they can bedevil you and stick in your mind forever.
Yeah, it's definitely a movie that emphasizes the enigmatic and suggestiveness.
And certainly no easy answers are offered here. No real happy ending. Everyone is still suffering in their various ways, but we've certainly seen examples of resilience and we've seen even a heartwarming friendship growing up here between Dr. Judd and Jason the poet. As Judd finally lays out the cards on the table, he's been withholding information about this old flame of Jason's and tells him finally, I've been keeping this from you because I thought it would hurt you to know it. I guess it's better for you to know that she went insane rather than just keep worrying about where she is and whether she's alive or not. And Jason says, well, all this time you've been my friend. It's got a little taste of Curse of the Cat People, where the search for friends is so essential as well. And the impact of discovering a real friend. You know, Val Lewton's lonely man telling stories about lonely people. Who better than Val Lewton to show us what it would mean to actually make a friend? Essential viewing, both of these films. Love to hear what people think about this one. Write us at theirbuggy@gmail.com or join the Discord. We've got Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto for a change. It's been a while at least. We went to see the 30th anniversary screening of Carlito's Way at the Review Cinema. Now we do have Carlito's Way on the schedule as part of our Al Pacino actor spotlight, but it's 10 years away, so we can have a discussion of the film here, I think.
I first saw this at the De Palma retrospective at TIFF, which was a few years ago. I don't know what, 5 years ago or something like that, and it was definitely one of my favorites.
I can't believe you hadn't seen it before then. I
had never really investigated De Palma very much before then. I basically only knew Carrie.
One of my absolute favorite directors. We do have some De Palmas on the schedule as special subjects as well.
I found it surprisingly emotional the first time I watched it. I was expecting that to happen again, and it really didn't.
Really?
Well, I can be very influenced by audience mood, and we had some very supercilious, talkative people near us in the audience, and I think they put me in the wrong mood.
Yeah, that was really unfortunate.
That's okay. It's just one of the hazards of seeing cinema with an audience of strangers. Sometimes that can be a great experience. When we saw Femme Fatale recently at the same cinema as part of the Neon Dreams series, the programmer, Brendan Ross, was so passionate and enthusiastic and very clear that nobody was even allowed to sit in this theater and watch this movie unless they felt the same way, that he really set the tone properly. But here there was no programmer, nothing, no tone to set, and I sometimes am a supercilious viewer, and I'm sure my mood has affected people around me in cinemas before. So anyway, all I'm saying is I think that's what happened. So I still enjoyed the movie a lot, I just didn't have, unfortunately, an emotional reaction to the ending. I almost started crying at the beginning, though, with that music. With De Palma, the thing is that there's such a combination always going on of Brechtian distanciation and florid emotionalism, and this movie is a pretty good example of that.
It's one of the ultimate De Palma concoctions.
It's the anti-Scarface. he obviously made it as an answer to Scarface, Al Pacino implausibly playing a Puerto Rican gangster.
Everyone's like, you know, when I first met you, you seemed like an Italian.
Sean Penn also has a fantastic role in this as his lawyer and greatest friend, David Kleinfeld. But yeah, so I was paying more attention to the mechanics of the film. And of course, it's very funny as well, this movie, because they're both giving hilarious performances as men who are on a total path of self-destruction from the beginning and never going to outrun it, although Al Pacino tries really hard to outrun it at the end. What I noticed this time around is that it's like a film noir in which Sean Penn's character is the femme fatale. He's even contrasted with the good woman, like the femme fatale often is, who tries to save Al Pacino from his doom and warn him against this evil influence of this person that he loves and he can't escape from this great love that he has.
The archetypal novel with that kind of structure is The Long Goodbye.
Right. Well, it's like that then. Kleinfeld turns out to be just as corrupt and nasty and betrays him every bit as thoroughly as Kathy does, as Jane Greer does Robert Mitchum in Out of the Past, right?
Yeah.
Just a nasty rabid dog that needs to be put down.
You a gangster now, Kleinfeld.
And Sean Penn's face, his expression when Al Pacino confronts him about, you did steal the money, didn't you? And he's just, speaking of naughty little children, he's just like a naughty little boy. And he's just like, yeah, I did.
Well, he hates these Goombas.
They've been pushing him around all his career. He clearly has PTSD.
Yeah.
And he's just snapped and he's decided, I'm going to be one of these guys now too. But as Al Pacino points out, no, you can't. And anyway, even all of those guys end up getting killed too.
Yeah, well, we certainly see a lot of them get killed in this movie.
And Pacino's character, in typical noir style, flashback of a dying man. So it's, you know, Double Indemnity. He has this romanticized notion of there being friendship in this world. And by the end of the movie, we see, and also of his generation being nobler or something.
Yeah, well, that's got so many antecedents. I mean, the classic distillation of that is High Sierra, where Bogey gets out of jail and has to pull this one last job with a bunch of jitterbugs and everything goes insane.
Well, yeah, part of the distanciation of the movie is that there's 1,001 noir and gangster film tropes in it, and they're all have great big flashing neon signs on them, right? And it just, with the use of the music and the cinematography, and it just becomes this whole lyrical ode to the genre. But by the end of the movie, we realize that none of these things are true, that there is nothing in this world whatsoever to romanticize. There is no friendship, there is no better generation, it's all just awful and nasty and everybody killing and betraying each other for no reason.
Well, except Penelope Ann Miller.
The good woman. Well, she's outside of this world, though.
She is, yes. Yeah, all of his old pals, I mean, Luis Guzman and Viggo Mortensen also playing a Latinx character. You know, not exactly the most culturally sensitive casting by De Palma here, and obviously it wouldn't be done this way now.
It's the early 90s.
Luis Guzman is the final betrayal, and dramatic irony. He gets through all of the levels of evil, right? And he gets to the train station, and he gets killed because of this sort of offhanded thing that he did, dissing Benny Blanco from the Bronx, John Leguizamo.
Yeah, who was just a nastier version of himself.
Yeah, basically.
It's just himself without this layer of romanticization.
Was like a hero worshiper at the beginning, right? And all he had to do was say, yeah, nice to meet you, kid. Yeah, I'll have a drink with you.
But it makes sense that this,
of course,
this blatant, naked double of himself is what he would hate.
Yeah, yeah. He's like, you're nothing. Fuck off. It's the only person he's really, really just brutally nasty with in the entire movie, because he's such a great guy otherwise. Even there, I mean, he's fighting really hard not to go all the way, and he tells us in his voiceover at the time, like, I have to kill Benny Blanco now that I've dissed him this badly and thrown him down the stairs, but I'm not gonna do it because I'm not that guy anymore.
Far more even than Jacqueline, this character has a death wish. He just has his death inside of him, and he believes that it is his fate because of where he's come from, right?
Yeah, but Jacqueline doesn't have any dreams of going to the Bahamas and selling cars. I mean, he really has that dream anyway. Maybe you're right, maybe he doesn't think it's ever gonna happen, but he certainly talks about it a lot in an optimistic way, and he almost gets there.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Just at the end, he tries to fight after he realizes that Kleinfeld isn't real. He somehow that spurs him to try to fight for this dream, but it's too late. Because he said he and Kleinfeld together have set everything in motion to doom him.
Yeah. As we said when we were walking home from the movie, Kleinfeld also helped to bring the Benny Blanco situation to a boil.
Yeah, Kleinfeld is just the worst. He's just responsible for everything that goes wrong.
I want to emphasize how much I like Penelope Ann Miller. She was an actress that, I don't know, she was in everything in the late 80s and early 90s, and I always liked her in everything, and I was like, when is she going to become like a name that people know? And it just didn't seem to happen.
Yeah, and apparently nobody knows or cares about this movie.
Well, that's ridiculous.
It's like The Fallen Sparrow.
De Palma fans know and love it.
Well, I mean, it did get this screening, so.
It's incredible. But we'll talk more about it in 2033. We'll see if you have an emotional experience when we watch it without those hecklers.
I actually think they enjoyed the film, just not in the way that I was enjoying it.
Not the right way, man.
Sometimes felt bad. For example, when we're watching the Sternberg movies, right? I'm laughing constantly throughout the movies because I think they're being funny on purpose, and I'm still having a very strong emotional reaction to them, to the Sternberg-Dietrich movies, and sometimes I've wondered, am I fucking up other people's experiences because I'm the only one laughing at these lines?
It is ironically distanced and hilarious, but also incredibly emotional. You should not be experiencing only one of those things. If you did, then you watched it wrong.
So we have a very special announcement. So hilariously, in some kind of coincidence, because I don't think it was because of reviews, but if you did rate and review and you're just not in America, so we don't know about it, thank you. But I did find out that we have moved into the top 5% listen notes category of podcasts globally. As recent listeners know, this is something I've been hoping for. I'm not even sure when it happened because my Google browser still won't tell me that that's 100% for sure the case. It's like I'm in a Schrodinger situation where depending how I look at the page, it says top 10% or top 5%. Even if I click on the thing that says top 5%, if I read the text, it's still saying top 10%. So I'm in some kind of black hole, wormhole situation. But Dave tells me we're definitely in the top 5%. Now, to put that in perspective, I think that nearly every podcast that has been consistently uploading for as long as ours has, which is about 9 years now, moves into the top 5%.
Hey, look, you can't control whether listeners find you or not, but I'm really glad that people have found us. We're getting our words out to the world, our thoughts and feelings, and that makes me happy.
And also people on Facebook who know nothing about podcasting thought this was very impressive.
We got some congratulations on it. I think we should take them. You know, again, we're not setting the world on fire. We're not going to monetize. I don't want to monetize. I don't want to have ads. But I don't listen to podcasts with ads, and I don't want to inflict that on anyone.
But Dave, at this rate, in 30 years, we could be in the top 1%, at which point you could probably slightly monetize it. So I think we've got a retirement supplement plan.
Well, that's possible.
So keep listening, everybody, especially if you're young.
But we won't do it the advertising way ever. That's for sure. Maybe Patreon or something. When we retire, we could record some things for patrons.
Next goal, top 1%.
Next week on the podcast, Dorothy McGuire, part 10, This Earth Is Mine and A Summer Place. This will be our second discussion of A Summer Place, as we did it in our double feature with A Summer with Monica.
This Earth Is Mine, is that the Henry King movie?
Yes, I have not seen this one. I'm looking forward to it.
So it's weird because it's one of those big, sprawling, epic melodramas, and it's directed by Henry King, who we like, but it has a horrible reputation, so we're going to check this out and see whether or not that's deserved.
It can't be as bad as people think it is. And A Summer Place.
That's great.
An incredible movie. Maybe we'll replicate everything we said last time, but
it's a really amazing mellow.
We'll find out if we have new thoughts or just rephrased old thoughts on it.